I'm Claire Grierson and I'm here to talk to you about responsible research innovation as part of the Perform Toolkit for early career researchers. So what is responsible research and innovation? What do we mean by that phrase? Well, it's about anticipating the implications and expectations of our research. So trying to work out what consequences our research might have, both the process of doing it, but also the outcomes of that research, the discoveries made. It's also about anticipating other people's expectations of the research, and thinking about our own expectations and comparing them to those of others, including funders, but also broader public who might hear about it or be affected by it while it's happening or after it's happened. In order to anticipate all these things, we need to have much better inclusion than you might imagine in the research team and in the research process. We need to include a really diverse range of people when we're planning the research and executing it, and in discussions about its possible implications and about expectations, so that we have a good chance of making that anticipation successful. Doing all of this will hopefully reduce risks. There are two important types of risks to bear in mind. Firstly, our research might have negative unintended consequences. We might not have expected something bad could happen because of what we've discovered or because of the process of research, but that could still happen, and we're trying to avoid that. Also, whether or not our research genuinely has negative consequences, there is a very real risk that it might not be accepted. There could be rejection of our research by the public or of its implications or applications. So the public might decide, or various communities might decide, to campaign against the use of our research and the application of our results. I first became aware that we really need to think about responsible research, innovation, and incorporate these different aspects and ideas into our research processes when I was growing up and training to become a researcher myself, because my father was one of the world's very first genetic engineers of food. He invented the first genetically modified food on the European market, which was a genetically modified tomato puree. The tomato puree was developed with the company ICI, which were then the biggest multinational in the world in the chemical companies. And it was released onto the market and sold well for about 18 months. There was a big debate about whether or not to label the tomato puree. Some people thought that it would lead to public rejection. Some people thought it was important the public knew what they were eating. In the end, the decision was made to label the puree, so it had a very clear label on the front, a blue label, I think, saying genetically modified. This had no effect on sales. My father did a large publicity campaign. He did about 40 radio and TV shows. He was on Radio 4, he was on BBC One, and he was in newspapers. It was culturally, you know, embedded and understood that this technology was going on. However, about 18 months after the launch, Monsanto released large amounts of genetically modified maize and soya into the market and announced they would not be able to trace it and that they wouldn't be labelling it. And this led to a pretty intense backlash. There had already been a small campaign against GMOs by organisations like Friends of the Earth and Greenpeace, but this hadn't really taken hold. However, with Monsanto's actions, there was a much stronger backlash, including front pages on newspapers like The Independent and The Guardian. And this had a very, very big effect. Very quickly, my father's product was removed from the supermarkets, there were negative stories in the press, and the phrase Frankenstein's tomatoes started to appear on the front pages of tabloids. UK funding and European funding for genetically modified plant research was very quickly wound down and replaced with funding for fundamental biology research. I'd been training to be a genetic engineer, and I thought I was going to be designing new food plants, new crop plants, all kinds of crazy ideas we had about the amazing things we were going to invent. And suddenly that was completely impossible. in all the biotechnology companies in Europe moved their research away. And if you wanted to stay in that field, you needed to go move abroad, somewhere like America. And those of us who were left in the UK trying to be young plant scientists had to start to compete for our funding with people who worked on yeast, on the fundamental biology of flies, worms, and started working on pure biological research without applications. And that lasted for a good 10 to 15 years. So what I'd like you to remember about this story about myself and my father is that whether or not you at the moment think you need to care about responsible research and innovation, it could have a really big effect on your career. It really matters what people think about your research, even people you've never met and will never meet. And it really matters that you take their thoughts on board. It became even clearer to me that I needed to think about responsibility when my research grants started to arrive with a form that I had to sign, where I had to write a statement that said, I have considered the ethical implications of my research. And I looked at that form and I thought, I've had no training in this. How can I say I've fully considered these? So what can you expect from an institution where you're working to help you with responsible research and innovation? Well, you should be getting good training and support. So programs like Perform, but also face-to-face training with local people who are involved in research and have experience of responsible research and innovation would be really helpful. The institution should be getting really good advice. So it needs a good group of advisors, and the research project that you're involved with needs to build a team of good advisors or have access to a group of people who can give it advice about responsible research innovation to help the team to plan. An institution can help with building really good relationships. It can provide bits of funding to help you to put together meetings and events, to run projects that help you to meet people who might be interested, to help you to reach out to a really diverse community and consult them whilst you're developing the ideas for your research right from the very start. Those relationships should not just include the people funding the research now, but also industries that might be involved in applications, other industries where there might be knock-on effects, but also policymakers. May there be one day a need for regulations around what you're doing or around its applications? Policymakers need to be aware that that need might be coming. It takes a long time to develop policy. Also, non-governmental organisations, charities, campaign groups, special interest groups of many kinds, they can be very, very important. So what would success look like if you were successfully doing responsible research and innovation? Well, your research will probably be more innovative because by consulting a more diverse group of people, you might get ideas that you might never otherwise have had. Researchers traditionally tend to be a particular group of people and with a particular set of views. But by consulting the sort of people who are never normally involved in research, you might get some really interesting ideas, especially if those people might be affected by the outcomes of the research. So your work might become more innovative, but also it might have fewer negative unintended consequences. You might be able to anticipate those better and avoid them altogether or find ways to ameliorate them. For example, by working with regulators or by developing training or policy that encourages good outcomes. All of this should reduce the frequency of negative unintended consequences, and that should reduce the risk of rejection. And if you can achieve all this, you should be able to innovate with much more confidence, with increasing confidence that all that investment that's being made in time, energy, money is not going to be wasted because of unanticipated rejection or unanticipated things going wrong. Hopefully, all of this can lead to science being seen as part of the solution to problems and not part of the problem. So here are some things you might like to reflect on. Is responsible research and innovation your problem? Who is most responsible in your team? Who should be most responsible? And if there's not enough responsible research and innovation practice going on, what can you do about it? What are the unintended negative consequences that your own research might have? Are there any ways that your work could be misused or abused that could hurt people or the environment or have other bad consequences that you've not really thought about? Are you inclusive enough? Is your project inclusive enough? Who else could be involved? Who else could you talk to? Who might have insight into how your research might be used or better done?